Hello and welcome to a new episode of Constructing Kingdoms with the Violet Howler, a literary analysis of the Kingdom Hearts story. In most conventional fantasy stories that revolve around light and darkness as supernatural forces, darkness is typically associated with evil. Some stories will try to soften it by treating darkness as representative of destruction or chaos, and depicted as an important element necessary for the universe to function, but the conflict still follows clear-cut lines of light good, dark bad. Settings that emphasize the need for balance between the two forces typically depict balance as the forces of light constantly fighting to keep the dark in check and prevent it from spreading out of control and destroying everything. But the conflict between light and darkness in Kingdom Hearts is not so simple and clean. On the surface, various characters talking about darkness and light not being able to exist without each other, while still treating darkness as something to keep in check, falls into the same pattern as your typical fantasy story. But it becomes much deeper when you listen to what the games are telling us about what these fundamental forces of the universe actually are. In this video, I will be exploring how the conflict between light and darkness is portrayed in the story of Kingdom Hearts in terms of Sora's coming-of-age narrative, and what the games propose as the solution to that conflict. In the Kingdom Hearts universe, light as a supernatural force is consistently shown representing and being generated by the connections between different people. Multiple characters over the course of the story talk about their connections with people they care about being the light that guides them. When Sora says in Kingdom Hearts 1 that he is searching for people he cares about, Cloud refers to those that he is looking for as his light. Later in the same game, Sora tells Kairi that the light from their hearts reversed his transformation into a heartless because their hearts were connected. And in Birth by Sleep, Aqua's Keyblade glows when she asks Terra and Ven to lend her their strength during her fight to free Ventus when he's possessed by Vanitas, representing the trio's bond, giving her the strength she needs. Conversely, darkness is shown to represent the absence of connection to others. We are shown on multiple occasions an individual's darkness becoming stronger due to emotional separation from other people. Young Xehanort spells this out directly earlier in Kingdom Hearts 3 when he talks about how Buzz's darkness grew when he and the other toys were separated from Andy.
Such tremendous darkness. All because he was ripped away from the boy who cares about him most. But if the light of friendship is a form of power, the darkness of being alone is a power even greater.
So from a literary perspective, the conflict between light and darkness in Kingdom Hearts is a representation of conflicts like selfishness versus selflessness, community versus isolation, conformity versus individuality. Whatever words you want to use, the idea of balance in Kingdom Hearts is ultimately about finding the middle road between focusing on others and focusing on yourself. When characters in Kingdom Hearts say that darkness is not inherently bad, what they mean is that focusing on yourself is not an inherently bad thing. Even people who dedicate themselves to helping others still need to set aside time to take care of their own needs. Where it becomes something negative is when you focus so much on yourself that you hurt the people around you. Which is an accurate description of all the Disney villains that Sora has faced across the series. Maleficent, Hades, Jafar, Scar, they're all so focused on themselves and their own desires that they don't care who they have to hurt or kill in order to feel satisfied. We also see this reflected in the character of Darkness in the final chapters of Union Cross, where it admits that it killed Strelitzia to grant Ven's desire for strength, not caring about the morality of its methods. Through these examples, Kingdom Hearts demonstrates that an excessive focus on oneself leads to harming other people in order to fulfill one's own selfish desires. The logical opposite, then, would be that focusing on others is not inherently good, because if too much darkness translates to hurting others to benefit yourself, then too much light would logically translate to hurting yourself to benefit others. Or, to quote Star Trek,
"If the needs of the many outweigh the needs of the few, or the one."
Following the logic of how darkness and light are portrayed means that the negative extreme of focusing on one's connections with others is for people to ignore their own individual well-being in order to serve a perceived greater good. We see this more obviously in Birth by Sleep, where Ericus is willing to murder his students, his own adoptive children, in order to prevent Xehanort's plans for another Keyblade War. Even though the decision clearly hurts him, he still follows through with the attempt because he thinks that the safety of the larger universe is more important than his own paternal feelings. The finale of Union Cross even reveals that the Master of Masters is following the same mentality on a significantly larger scale. The master used the trust and faith his six apprentices had in him, and the trust their disciples had in them, to engineer a war so that he could set himself, the foretellers, and the union leaders up as vessels to trap and permanently destroy darkness. When Lushu expresses horror at this, the master outright says that they cannot afford to let their feelings get in the way of winning the conflict against darkness. But on a more personal scale, we see this mentality introduced right under our noses in the original game with Sora himself. On two significant occasions, Donald and Goofy discourage Sora from expressing any emotional pain over his situation by telling him that he can't come along if he doesn't put on a happy face. They mean well and were obviously trying to cheer him up in the middle of what was clearly an incredibly chaotic and stressful situation. But what they inadvertently communicated was that his individual pain was not important, and that the ability to reunite with his friends was conditional on him hiding it. Because of this, even so many games later, Sora continues to brush aside his own pain and negative emotions while refusing to let his friends ever see the full extent of his pain. But the longer someone puts off addressing their pain, the more the pain grows until they reach their breaking point. The longer they ignore it, the bigger the fallout. Like Mickey said in the first game, the closer you get to the light, the greater your shadow becomes. So in the context of light and darkness as metaphors on a coming-of-age journey, this big cosmic struggle represents learning to find a healthy compromise between these two extremes in order to function as a mature adult. From there, the question becomes, how do you achieve that balance in a meaningful way? After all, Birth by Sleep and Dream Drop Distance tell us that it's ineffective, even dangerous, to try and combat darkness with light. Because through these past examples, the series tells us that trying to drown out one's inner darkness with more light and focus on others, whether on a physical or an emotional level, only serves to amplify a person's darkness. Even if you get rid of an external source of darkness, like destroying the villain who's hurting others for their own selfish ends, new sources of darkness will always pop up later like a game of whack-a-mole. Pretty much the same thing in Star Wars. No matter how many times the Sith are defeated, both in canon and legends, we continue to witness Jedi falling to the dark side because their entirely human reactions to painful situations went against the Jedi Order's philosophy of selflessness and lack of attachment. Anakin Skywalker becomes Darth Vader out of a panicked desire to prevent his wife's death because of his fear of losing the people he loves. Asajj Ventress falls to the dark side when she lashes out in grief over her Jedi mentor's death and goes on a rampage to take revenge on the people who killed him. Trilla Siduri in the game Jedi Fallen Order becomes an Inquisitor after being tortured out of a combination of self-preservation and anger at her teacher for giving up her location and abandoning her. So what does Kingdom Hearts propose as the solution to this cycle? How do you find the middle road between selfishness and selflessness? To try and find an answer, let's take a look at what the Kingdom Hearts games actually tell us. In Dream Drop Distance, what dispels the darkness that possessed the musical score in the Symphony of Sorcery was two sound ideas, the combination of which Mickey refers to as a powerful harmony, and explicitly identified as a representation of the bond between Sora and Riku. The connection between the two sound ideas in this game is represented by the musical theme Dearly Beloved, which plays on the main menu of every single Kingdom Hearts game in the entire series. And Dearly Beloved is a phrase that is most commonly heard as part of the opening lines of a wedding ceremony. Meanwhile, in Kingdom Hearts 3, Larxene describes Elsa as being pulled between light and darkness due to her fear of her own ice powers. What enables her to resolve that inner conflict and achieve total control of her powers is her love for her sister saving Anna from being frozen solid. And in Toy Box, it's Woody's love for Andy that manages to break through the darkness that young Xehanort was using to hold Buzz captive. These things tell us that the answer to the question of how one finds balance between light and darkness, selflessness and selfishness, is love. Given the way that the series repeatedly utilizes character and story archetypes from classic fairy tales, a genre that Disney's entire brand image was built on, it makes sense from the perspective of storytelling tradition that true love has been set up as the thing that resolves the main conflict of the Kingdom Hearts universe. It is especially fitting given that the narrative itself actually raises the question of what love is. In 358 Days, Roxas questions what love is after Zaldan uses the word love to describe the relationship between Belle and the Beast. Then in Kingdom Hearts 3, Sora literally says that he still doesn't really understand love after witnessing the relationship between Will and Elizabeth in the Pirates of the Caribbean world. and beyond the games themselves, the supplemental Character Files short story collection that Square Enix released a full year after Kingdom Hearts 3 features multiple stories centered around Sora actively asking what love is and how it relates to his own experiences. When a story specifically has the protagonist question what love is, narrative continuity requires that said protagonist be provided with an answer at some point before the story reaches its conclusion. But when the characters are questioning what love is, they aren't just referring to any type of love, or to all love in general. The fact that Roxas and Sora are specifically asking what love is in the context of their experiences witnessing the relationships between established Disney couples indicates that while we see multiple platonic examples of love being a way to find balance, the experiences of the original characters are going to have an emphasis on romantic love. This is supported by the fact that Aqua first poses the thematic question of what she's supposed to do if not destroy darkness as Eric has taught her, in the context of witnessing the reunion of a romantic Disney couple at the end of her visit to the Castle of Dreams in Birth by Sleep. Not only that, but in 358 Days, the fact that, while trying to help Roxas understand love, Axel says that love is not a step above or below being best friends, indicates that their conversation is not referring to love in the platonic sense. But regardless of what form of love a character ends up relying on to find balance, it's significant in this context that Kingdom Hearts uses Disney worlds to showcase multiple forms of love, and that the narrative never tries to frame any one form as better than the others. When characters are questioning what love is, being exposed to multiple different types of love helps them to refine their understanding by providing them with a basis for comparison, that they can then contrast their own relationships against in order to determine the appropriate labels for which types of love they feel for a specific person. This all ties back to the metaphor behind the conflict between light and darkness, because many of the examples of love that Sora and Roxas have seen throughout the Disney worlds, both romantic and platonic, manage to embody both selfishness and selflessness at the same time. On the one hand, many Disney characters, in either Kingdom Hearts or their original movies, are ultimately willing to put the needs, desires, and safety of others before their own desire to be with the person or people they love. Like the Beast canceling his deal with Belle so that she can go save her father, assuming she won't come back and accepting that his curse will never be broken, but still putting her desires first. Or how Triton gives Ariel legs at the end of The Little Mermaid, putting her curiosity about the human world and her love for Eric over his desire as her father to keep her sheltered and protected from danger. Yet at the same time, they also want the other person to remain a part of their life no matter what. That desire to hold on to the other person is selfish in its own way, with how the person will make decisions based on how it will affect their ability to be with the person they love. Like Hercules turning down an immortal life on Olympus with his birth family in favor of a mortal life on Earth with Meg. Or how Mulan accepts a position as one of the Emperor's bodyguards in Kingdom Hearts 2 so that she can work alongside Shang and continue to be near him. These characters both want the person they love to be by their side, and at the same time are willing to prioritize the other person's needs and happiness above that personal desire. They can be happy as long as they can see that the person they love is happy. But at the same time, the reverse is also true, that it hurts them as well to see the person they love in pain, physically or emotionally. But it's because of their love that they will attempt to ease their loved one's pain in any way that they can. And if they can't remove that pain, then they are still willing to share that pain so that the person they love doesn't have to endure it alone. It's much like Data Nominee described at the end of Recoded, that sharing your pain with someone close to you will help ease the burden. And for romantic love specifically, does that not sound like the first part of the common line from Wedding Vows in Sickness and in Health? We can agree to disagree over which relationships among the Kingdom Hearts cast will be platonic and which will be romantic, but Kingdom Hearts using romantic relationships to communicate its main themes is a common literary technique in fiction. When a creator focuses their work around a particular theme, everything in the story, up to and including the relationships between the characters, serves as commentary and reflection on those central ideas. For example, the love triangle in the Hunger Games trilogy ultimately represents Katniss struggling to figure out what she hopes to gain from rebelling against the Capitol. Whether she wants revenge and destruction, represented by Gale, or a new beginning and the better life she could never have under the current system, represented by Peeta. Meanwhile, all the relationships in Good Omens, from Aziraphale and Crowley to Sergeant Shadwell and Madame Tracy, represent the message of finding common ground with people you've been taught to believe are your mortal enemies. So Kingdom Hearts presenting love as the one true way to find balance between focusing on others and focusing on yourself, with a specific emphasis on romance, is ultimately no different than the many stories that have come before. Thank you all so much for watching. If you are interested in more of my literary dissection of the Kingdom Hearts story, feel free to hit the subscribe button, and I'll see you back here again on December 25th for my next video.